So for the sake of tonight's presentation, my story kind of starts actually within a small three-block area in New York City. We were actually approached originally by the New Museum, and in the context of a festival that they were hosting for world leaders and mayors from around the world to convene and to talk about transformations of public space. And so the New Museum contacted my friends. I'm not sure why or how we got the call, but they suggested what would happen if we set loose a number of artists, in fact, about 60 artists, loose in this block of New York to try and transform it with digital art through experience, public activations during the night. So never having done actually a festival before, never having done what was at the time called projection mapping, still called 3D projection mapping, but being an artist and knowing however we can, eventually we will figure this out. We took this undertaking on. So what we did was we started walking around these city streets and we started to think about how could we recontextualize them, or actually first offer a canvas to artists who live in the area so that they could come in and they could transform this public space through public art, through projection, through light performance, installations, all temporary over the course of one evening. So we took kind of inventory of what assets we had within the city. We would make this map. We looked at the different architecture, the buildings, the vacant alleyways, architectural scrim on the sides of building. And for our purposes, we kind of took a first stab at presenting to the artists what we thought were going to be rich canvases for them to repurpose. We then sat around a bunch of round tables every weekend. We'd sit on a Sunday and we'd sit with groups of community leaders, local activists, neighborhood people, artists, and we would talk about, so because we wanted this work to be contextual. We didn't want to kind of land like this creative alien ship in the middle of New York and kind of make a burn mark and then fly away. We wanted to do something that could have some relevance to the community, could maybe be a reflection to them and be relevant to the people who participated in it. So we had this solicitation. We had several hundred artists who came in, contributed. We selected from them. We had a curatorial team. And the idea was, how can we completely transform this three-block radius of New York using projection and performance? So we looked at the New Museum. At the time, although we perhaps had access to the technology to do something a little fancier, we just couldn't afford it. So what we took upon ourselves to do was, what we had was a camera. What we could make was small models. So what we did was we ended up making 3-foot-tall models, 11-foot-tall models, even 3-inch-tall models. And we provided these as templates to the artists that we worked with. And we would film them in various scales. And the artists could work in whatever mode or medium that they were comfortable with. So here you'll see an acrylic model. We had artists filling them, burning them, melting them, paper, mache, different mediums and different modes for different artists, depending on what they were working with. Fashion artists came in and wrapped the New Museum in silk ribbons. And the amazing power of this technology being projection is that it is infinitely scalable, that we can take something 3 inches tall or 3 feet tall, and we can effectively scale it 256 feet tall the next day using 13 projectors on a building 500 feet away on a 13-story building. Similarly, we empowered 33 other artists, none of which worked in the digital realm, to kind of repurpose this public space. We had Ichiban floral artists. We had a woman who came and crocheted a 3-foot-tall hat over the New Museum, only to see the New Museum essentially unravel into the night sky. One artist who I couldn't for the life of me figure out what she was going to do, but she mixed silver leaf with a bottle of vodka, didn't drink it, but poured it over the New Museum. Made no sense to me at the time, except to stand back a week later and to see the New Museum turn into a molten, glistening kind of lava lamp as it just kind of eroded into the pavement beneath it. So amazing medium, and from that point forward, I was effectively hooked. So what we did was brought this platform to Boston, because I kept thinking to myself, why am I accumulating the number of parking tickets that I am in New York? My son doesn't remember what I look like, and he's wondering, why aren't you doing this in Boston? So here we have an amazing catalyst for creative intervention to bring artists, technologists, performance, and all the institutions that we have in Boston together for one experience where we can convene and we can transform our public space through the eye of an artist using projection and these temporary means of kind of creative intervention. We'll be right back. So what happened, we started with this festival. I think we had 20,000 people show up the first time. We used whatever social media networks we could possibly bring together to invite artists and participants to come and to see this. And then what happened is the next year we got a big shot in the arm and got essentially sponsored by Hub Week, MIT, Harvard, Boston Globe, MGH, Red Sox. And all of a sudden the entire city came together to try and make this festival happen. So this time we have close to 40,000 people showing up at Fenway Park. We've turned the backside of Fenway Stadium into a giant playable pavilion. So here you have artists strapped, tethered, or tied to the steel girders of the building. We've set contact microphones into the steel girders, and we have calibrated or at least documented what each sound of these steel beams would make, and it turns into a giant playable pavilion for up to 90 artists over the course of the night. So this was called Waking the Monster. Similarly, enabling a classically trained pianist to take a Chopin piece and turn it into a 200-foot wide canvas behind her while her hands play across the entirety of the backdrop. People could walk into these public spaces, be trapped in a light. You see that augmented reality would overlay. If you stood there for more than a few seconds, birds would begin to land on your shadow. You would become these strange characters. And this really is a perfect example of kind of mixed realities, where we're now merging technologies into built environments to kind of create these kind of fantasful experiences. So now streetscapes become interactive canvases. Playgrounds become interactive galleries. Here you have alleyways or these immersive spaces. You're fitting people into places they probably shouldn't be, and, you know, putting them in a context that is somewhat uncomfortable to them, because in a city environment, especially like Boston, we're a little bit conservative, putting us in confined space. But it's interesting to see what happens when you use contemporary art and you use these type of activations to break down these barriers and to create these type of interactive experiences for people. We even had our own security system installed at one point, had absolutely no theft during the entire festival. And the new scale that we now use for our festivals is that if there are not people dancing or making out in the corner, complete failure. So, and this, I say that jokingly, but it's amazing to see what happens when you abandon for a moment the return on investment scenario that's typically tied to kind of corporate projects, where what's the return? What is this marketing? What are we communicating? And when you simply approach a project from the standpoint of putting smiles on faces, and that's the return on investment, changing people's opinions and views on space and the way that they interact in the public spaces that they walk through every day in this new context. So now we started getting phone calls. What can you do with our interior space? We got a neoclassical space. So we would provide this canvas for artists who could adapt their artwork to the architectural details of the interior. And then we started getting calls from buildings. Here, the Gansevoort Hotel in New York said, we have a 15-story building. We would like to do a projection mapping installation. This was a non-permitted piece for which I was wearing camouflage while we were playing this piece on a building across the street, hoping that everything would go smoothly. So you can just see how powerful a medium this is. You can, once you turn the lights off and you turn these projectors on, this new reality prevails. So this is a very powerful medium that we started to see all these commercial applications for. We would get calls, for example, from Audi or from this company Delphi Technologies, who struggled for years to communicate what their micro-sensing technologies would do inside cars, so they could communicate to their investors and to potential car dealers that they would work with how their sensing technologies worked. So what we did was we created a completely kind of augmented reality canvas in which we were projecting everything onto this 36-foot stage. We were projecting onto this car from all three sides, essentially unwrapping it like a big projection mapped gift. And as a result, we could make the car transparent. And from certain vantage points within the audience, we could completely delaminate the car. We could peel away its exterior and we could show all these components and what they were doing, to the extent to where we even eliminated the stage lighting here. So when a speaker would walk out on stage, they would be followed by a virtual light as they walked across, because we found any lights to be just a contamination of our canvas otherwise. So here you can see what this looked like.
Jeff,
people walked into the room thinking there was a car underneath a silk canvas. So later on, we got a call from the Creative Writers Museum in Chicago. And this was an interesting installation because we have both physical and we have this virtual overlay of projection mapped content. In this case, we have text where we used a nanoparticle. It was actually engineered by an MIT physicist. We found our own kind of ad hoc version of it. We found a way to screen it onto a wall surface. So this text is actually screened and fixed, and it's excerpts from American writers. And what we've done is we've highlighted it by projecting the exact same text back on top of it. As a result, what we have is this canvas where we can extract or highlight different narratives within the work, and we can have images that emerge from the text. So what you can see here is that each little character becomes a pixel within a larger landscape or this image. So the image begins to reveal itself over time. Likewise, the text you'll see emerges that highlights whatever the excerpt of that writer's work was. So this changes, supports 16 different writers over the course of the day, and you can sit and watch these narratives reveal themselves. So what's been interesting now, I've been saying a little bit about augmented reality. Here now we have application at Toyota Research Institute just down the street here, where we wanted to play with VR applications. So we have content that's essentially generated in a virtual environment. So in this case, imagine walking into a room. We have pixel mapped content that is perfectly mapped to the facets on a dimensional wall surface. And you walk into the room and you are a blue source of light. We have a Kinect camera that's tracking you walking. It's projecting blue light onto the wall. Inversely, someone approaches from the opposite side of the hallway and starts walking towards you. They're a red source of light. All of this content now, not being pre-rendered or in a linear sequence, but now being rendered in real time in a gaming engine, projected back into the actual environment. So I was saying how earlier, you know, these festivals ended up being for us a testing ground. It was like R&D in public space. One project that I probably at the time had no idea would circle around as it did was this one, Your Big Face. So we had an artist here, sorry, skipping name, edit that later, please. New American Public Arts, who came together and did this, Dan Sternoff-Beyer, sorry, that was the name I was trying to remember. Dan Sternoff-Beyer was an artist who came together with New American Public Art to do this commission, and their idea was to build a 16-foot tall head out of coroplast. So we worked with them to engineer this giant head, which was then strapped to the side of a building in the south end. The idea being that you could sit in real time in front of this head and have your face projected on top of it. So we had a line 3,000 and 4,000 people long over the course of this festival who wanted to see their big face up on the side of the building. Vanity art, it's a fine line. So I would have never thought that this project would come, you know, full circle. And yet again, a few weeks later, I get a call from an artist, Krzysztof Wodyczko from Harvard GSD program. And in this case, what we're doing is we're capturing video, 33 interviews with Harvard students about their frank and real experiences as Harvard students. What we did was we basically trapped them in this, what looks like a torture device, hold their head perfectly still, and we videotaped them for hours doing interviews about their experiences at Harvard. We gave them a means of registering themselves. And ultimately what happened was we projected their interviews back onto the John Harvard sculpture so they could encompass the body of John Harvard, who, as you guys know, isn't in fact John Harvard. The funny backstory of this is you can't project on polished bronze. So we ended up having to spray a rubberized mat, almost giving John Harvard a facial the day before we shot this. Ultimately, we had 33 students whose faces were perfectly mesh warped in animations, and they took over the body of John Harvard for a course of a week at Harvard. last time we're ever going to see a big head project, right? Until a few weeks later, after finishing that project, we get a call from an artist, Matthew Moore. In this case, a 16-foot tall LED head, who he's requested, you should be able to walk in the back of this head. I want your head to be scanned in real time, and I want you to become the face. So now at this point, the company that I had started a few years prior, where I'm doing festivals and these rogue type art installations, was essentially acquired by a company with 300,000 square feet of manufacturing facility and 300 employees. So now anything's possible. So what we did was we embarked on this journey with this artist, Matthew Moore, out of Ohio, Columbus, Ohio, and we started working with him to study the human head. You know, how do we come up with the most homogeneous head that is not male nor female, can't be any decipherable race whatsoever, that is the perfect head, as embarrassing as it is to say that on stage. So we looked at big heads and small heads and medium heads, and we came up with the perfect head being a medium to small head. Just so you guys know, we then had to work within the constraints of technologies that were available to us. In this case, we're using a very high resolution LED display, which we had to have custom manufactured in these tiny little facets so they could wrap around the curvilinear form of this face. What started out as just 8 layers tall turned into 24 layers tall, 6-inch facets each. Everything is removable by magnets from the face. And we did curve studies, you know, what does it require to make a curved face that looks realistic to where we don't diminish the detail to the extent that it looks compromised. And this, as I said before, the perfect head. Small, medium, human head. What I forgot to mention before was what was amazing was that we found a study that OSHA had done where they had in fact scanned 5,000 human heads. So we had this database available to us where we could average out these heads and we could cut them up and we could essentially arrive at this form at the end of this study, the before and the after. So now we have a photo booth to resolve. So now we bring our team of creative technologists together, working with a group out of Maryland as well, and we start studying this process of photogrammetry and taking pictures fast, and how do we recreate a 3D model of a human head in under 30 seconds so that it can become a 16-foot tall, super high resolution LED sculpture in real time. So we used photogrammetry, which ultimately ended up being 30 Pi cams that were installed or integrated inside inside of this booth. What they do is they take pictures of you from a bunch of different angles, and no different than cell phone triangulation that knows your location as a result of three locations. In this case, you have three images taken that overlap, and essentially there's an algorithm that can recomposite your head in 3D. So it will shoot you from 30 different angles and then create a 3D model as a result of the information. Then we apply a layer yet again of facial recognition. So when you think about it, the perfect head may not be your head, I'm sorry to say. So what we need to do is we need to move your eyes, nose, ears, and mouth into the perfect position to now make you part of the perfect head project. And so what happens is the facial scanning process simultaneously recognizes eyes, nose, ears, and mouth, moves everything to its appropriate location so that it will align with the sculpture. As you can see here on the left, this guy, if his poor unfortunate head was scanned and not calibrated, his ears would be in the wrong place, his nose would be in the middle of his mouth, and so on and so forth. Now in this case, we do a lot of prototyping. We, in fact, use 3D projection mapping to do some rapid prototyping to understand what this would look like at full scale. Engineer this. We actually do work this fast because we have a budget. So the interesting thing is that this was built entirely in Boston by a team of about 30 fabricators. We ended up having to build it in three separate sections. It weighs 7,000 pounds. And in fact, it actually has a drive system to it as well. So with a remote control, it will drive into place. It will rotate 180 degrees every evening. The idea being that it is a public sculpture that's facing the interior of the convention center during the day. However, at night, it rotates 180 degrees and faces outdoors. So the brains of the operation are in fact installed in the brains of the head. We literally had a forklift lift a giant, probably $90,000 computer system and load it into the back of this head. Inside, again, you have 30 Pi cams, which are tethered together. We have an array of lights so that you have a uniform lighting surface. and we created a user interface that would allow the person to register their head in the context of the scanning process. Again, this all happens in 30 seconds. See, proof we do work this fast.
My hope is that people interact with the sculpture and they feel energized and they feel challenged and they feel engaged. I think a lot of people are just going to enjoy having their picture up on a giant head. I think it'll be a lot of fun for a lot of people.
And that's it. Thank you.